Yeah, please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the Republic for which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening and welcome to the Hampton Board of Selectmen meeting for February 6th. First thing is on is public comment period. Is there anybody from the public that would like to speak?
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jed Carpentier, and I'm here on behalf of the Professional Firefighters of Hampton. I wanted to just first take the time to come in here and personally thank each of the board members for their unanimous support of our contracts. I think that that personally means a lot to me and my members that I represent, having the unanimous support of the five of you sitting up here, and I think that carries a lot of weight within the community. So thank you guys for that. Thank you for those of you who made some comments during deliberative sessions the other day. We greatly appreciate those, helping keep that positive momentum going forward for these contracts. So, and anything else that you folks think you could do between now and then or were willing to do to help us support those is greatly appreciated, because we know every single vote counts. So, and we know each of you have your own pool of constituents that you can draw from. So any influence that you are willing to dedicate to this is greatly appreciated. Thanks to the negotiation committee for a fair negotiation. So this is, and from our perspective, a very fairly negotiated contract that brings value back to the taxpayers and our members at the same time. And I think what we were able to do as a negotiations team, being us as the firefighters and the fire officers and the members from the Board of Selectmen, were able to really intermingle that value and find that balancing act of how do we act responsibly for the taxpayers and still take care of our employees and keep them heading in a positive direction. And I think this contract was impressively did that. So thank you to the negotiations team on that. Some of the things, reasons why I personally feel as though it is a great value, there's for the voters out there that are listening now, I'm not sure where the camera is, so I'm not sure which way to look on that one, but there's some real concessions made on healthcare and our prescription plans that brings money back to the table. Some of that value was brought back in some of the, in the cost of living adjustments, which from all the research that I've done, these cost of living adjustments are on par with what the private business sector is projecting for the coming years. So I think that's great that we're keeping track with that and trending in a positive direction. And I think most importantly with these contracts going forward, I think it sets the tone for our members and our department to not only, we're going to show up and give it our best every day. We always do. But at the end of the day, we need to attract the right people that are willing to continue to do that. And I think a three-year deal, a term of this length, really speaks volume to one issue that we have going forward, and that's staying competitive with the towns around us. And I think this keeps us competitive with our surrounding communities that perform like responsibilities. So I think that's a great thing. At the end of the day, I'd like to ask the voters and the board to please vote yes on 15 and 16 for the fire officers, fire alarm operators, and firefighters' contracts. And I hope they feel comfortable doing that, to recognize that there is a true value for both sides there. Thank you for your time. If there's any questions, I can answer those, but thank
you.
Set.
Thank you, Jed.
Thanks, Jed.
Anybody else who'd like to speak in public comment? Seeing none. Announcements and community calendar. Regina?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to say something. I'd like to announce to this board and the public that as of today, I have been noted as a grassroots speaker at the Water 2.0 conference scheduled in April for this year. This conference is sponsored by General Electric Digital. And what it is participants of this conference will include water and energy industry authorities, utilities professionals, EPA representatives, and potential private investors such as General Electric. The purpose will be to present the town of Hampton's infrastructure needs, mainly focusing on wastewater and wastewater treatment plant infrastructure needs. Presenting the town's five-year capital improvement plan on these items and discussing additional federal funding, tax credits, as well as potential private investment. The information to be presented by myself at this conference has been developed, laid out, and explained to me by both the director and deputy director of the Public Works Department. Without the excellent five-year capital improvement plan outlined for both of these subjects, I would not know where to begin at this conference. And I would just like to thank you, thank the public, and I would like to thank Chris and Jen of Public Works under the leadership of Fred for getting me the information that I can present so that hopefully we can find some alternative funding for our town and its needs. Thank you.
Jim?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We had our deliberative session last Saturday. It was attended by about 75, I guess, voters. There was a lot of discussion on various issues. I really encourage all the voters to look at the Warren articles, look at what the election's going to bring, look at both sides of the issue, and weigh which way you want to vote. But please do it intelligently and look and research before you go. Now, the election is March
14th,
Tuesday, March 14th at Winnicunnet. So please get out there and vote, but please pay attention to everything beforehand and do your research. And no matter which way you vote, exercise your right to vote. Thank you.
Mr. Bean.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Bridle. Great town meeting at the high school. And I just wanted to comment briefly, and very briefly, because the document really doesn't even deserve to be recognized, but it is out there. And it is it's from Mr. Silberdick from the Rational Taxpayers. And he's looking for money to support his letter. And it's the standard six-pack of totalitarian disinformation, opprobrium, inaccuracy, character assassination, and misogyny, and pugnacious nonsense that we've come to expect from that group. And if you didn't get it, it's because he's only solicited the highest tax properties in town. But he virtually goes across the gamut from department heads to the selectmen, and nobody's good enough for him. And I just wanted to share my continued disappointment with this kind of effort in propaganda smear against the good town of Hampton. And that's why there are elections, and I'm proud to serve with this board, and I'm proud to serve with department heads and proud of this town. Proud that everybody has moved away from the nonsense, and glad to know that periodically this is the only indignity that we have to suffer is people smearing the town and soliciting money from the top 10% of taxpayers in the town. Thank you, Mr. Bridle.
Yeah, I would just like to thank everybody that did come to the deliberative session, and maybe if word gets out that it was the shortest one in recent memory, that maybe that will help people want to come again, or at least part of the day. Because it was out at least, I'd say, a couple hours earlier than usual.
At least.
Yeah, so it worked out very well. Thank you.
I believe the school's deliberative session is Thursday night at 7 o'clock.
Yes, I think you're correct.
At the Hampton Middle School. That will be the SAU 90's deliberative session. Will be Thursday night at 7. Also, Mr. Bean, send our best wishes to your mom. I heard she's been sick, and hopefully a speedy recovery.
Thanks so much, Mr. Bridle.
Next thing we have is a consent agenda. We have a road closure permit, a parade and public gathering license, use of town property, town offices for the garden club, entertainment license, lease land renewals, and a 2017 land rent commitment list.
I'll move the consent agenda.
Motion to move it, seconded.
May I just ask a question of the town manager?
Sure.
On the road closures and entertainment, there's been no input by the police negatively or anything?
Let me check.
Okay.
The road closure, I know they're moving a house down there, and that's why that one.
That's okay. Why they're doing that one, yeah.
And the
Eastern States 20-miler?
The chief has signed the permits.
Okay, so there's no problem.
There should be no problem at all.
Okay.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Approval of minutes, January 23rd.
I'll make the motion and we approve the minutes.
I'll second.
Motion by Regina, seconded by Jim. All those in favor? Unanimous. Or, wait a minute. Are you here? You're going to abstain, Rick. You weren't here, right?
Yeah.
All right. So 4-1 abstention. Next thing is appointments. Chief Ayotte, and I believe Deputy Kennedy.
Correct. Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you.
The deputy's passing around a document that we'll talk about in just a few minutes.
Yes, I believe you have.
Thanks, XO.
So before I begin on the state of the state when it comes to the fire department, I would like to just reference Mr. Griffin's position on the shortest meeting in recent memory. I think that that is absolutely true, and also it's a reflection on the professionalism presented by this group, as well as the town moderator, who I thought did a fantastic job of moving things along that day. He did a really great job, and he should be recognized for that. This evening, I'd like to say thank you very much on behalf of the deputy and I for having the opportunity to come and speak with you. Since our last visit, there have been a few personnel changes at Hampton Fire Rescue. One firefighter was medically retired as a result of a work-related injury. His vacancy was filled with a probationary firefighter who I had spoken about in November. He started the first week of November, worked for 1 month, and resigned his position. He stated that he did not feel that Hampton Fire Rescue was a good fit for him. We've recovered all of his equipment, and this leaves the department with one vacancy that we're actively working to fill. Second vacancy, which I had talked to you about in November, was filled with a process that ended in December. And our newest probationary firefighter, Gary Lemoyne, was sworn in on February 1st, 2017. We certainly do welcome him aboard. He comes to Hampton from Newmarket Fire Department and has a significant history here. His father, Kevin Lemoyne, was a longtime firefighter and fire alarm operator here in the town of Hampton. Attached to the quarterly report, you will find a fire incident analysis, which provides a breakdown for the calls of service for Hampton Fire Rescue that we've been answering, and the following summaries of our activities. Hampton Fire Rescue answered a total of 4,517 calls for service in 2016. The breakdown is 2,140 fire calls and 2,377 patient contacts. There's a small chart, and I know that the folks at home don't see it, but the Board of Selectmen does. This indicates our history of our past 5 years. Did you receive this, by the way? I'm sorry. Okay.
I don't have it.
So what you're seeing is a historical perspective over the last 5 years. In 2012, we saw a total of 3,945 calls for service. 2013 was 3,870. 2014, we saw 4,362. In 2015, 4,416. And in 2016, 4,517 calls. As far as the fire side, we responded to 48 reportable fires in Hampton in 2016. We responded to one reported building fire in the month of January, and we remain at about average for the reported number of fires in the last 5 years. Fire that occurred last month was at 123 Ashworth Avenue. This is a multiple occupancy dwelling that had 5 residents. All were able to escape. One had minor injuries as a result of attempting to extinguish the fire himself. Thankfully, there were no fatalities and no other injuries were reported. The fire displaced 5 residents from 3 apartments. The fire happened at 7:39 on Saturday night on January 28th. The beach station is located about 6 blocks from the structure. On arrival, the lieutenant of Engine 4 was told that the building was occupied and that there was possibly people trapped. So he arrived to find heavy fire throughout the bottom floor and it was extending to the second. He immediately called fire alarm to call for the first alarm to be struck and also for an ambulance to be dispatched to the scene. Worried about people being inside. Engine 1 arrived and established a water supply, and Seabrook was called immediately on the transmitted box alarm as our ladder 1 was out of service for repair. This fire came in following a medical aid call, or a subsequent call, which you'll hear about later. A simultaneous call. And the ambulance was out of the area as they had transported to the Portsmouth Regional Hospital. We had one firefighter in on recall that responded on Engine 1. Two came in for the struck box and took Engine 3 to the scene. And one firefighter went to the scene in his personal vehicle with his own gear. The ambulance returned from the hospital and went directly to the scene. We were supported by several mutual aid companies and are grateful for their support. This fire, like most fires, required several teams. It was especially important to perform search and rescue with the reports that were received from the bystanders. Ultimately, this fire was brought under control in just over 40 minutes. Upon arrival, we were told that there was a victim potentially in the first floor, and so the primary search was conducted, the secondary search was conducted, and we had two teams look to make sure that there was nobody there, and that also for the back apartment and the top floor apartment. That's a lot of crews working at the same time. On the emergency medical services side, we had a total of 2,377 patient contacts in 2016. Calls for service include 83 calls for chest pain, 5 were STEMIs, or ST elevation, MI, myocardial infarction, 18 calls for cardiac arrest, 163 other types of cardiac calls. We had 29 calls for stroke, and 280 calls for a variety of trauma. Camden Fire has administered Narcan a total of 46 times in 2016, which is an increase of 18% over last year. We continue to see opiate overdose as a problem in our society. This past month, we saw 8 calls for chest pain, 2 cardiac arrests, 3 other types of cardiac calls, 20 trauma-type calls, and 3 overdoses. Narcan's been administered 5 times in 2017, and I believe that number has gone up. In conference with my EMS officer this morning, I believe we had 2 other additional overdoses this weekend. No fatalities in our town on that one this weekend. Cardiopulmonary resuscitation education remains a high priority, and we continue to bring this life-saving education to the community. And we remain vigilant to reduce the risk of injury to our providers. Since last speaking with you, we made a purchase, and in order to reduce the potential for injuries associated with lifting patients into the lifting the stretcher into the back of the ambulance, we installed a power load system on A1, which is our newest ambulance. This device is capable of lifting up to 870 pounds, and it eliminates the need to have several providers working to load the stretcher in the back of the ambulance with a patient on it. In fire prevention, the Fire Prevention Bureau performed 271 inspections, issued 193 permits, and collected $16,108.40 in fees. The table that I provided shows a historical comparison for the last 3 years. That's the data that we have able to be sorted. So in 2014, we had 163 inspections and issued 163 permits and collected a total of $4,575. In 2015, following an adjustment by the board to allow an increase in fees, we did 155 inspections, issued 180 permits, and collected a total of $20,297.30. In 2016, we had a total of 271 inspections, issued 193 permits, and collected $16,108.40. The disparity there is as a result of the fact that the major part of 2015 saw a great deal of new construction, and in 2016 there was a lot more inspection services, which is a little bit different in the fee structure. There was a total of 16 display fireworks inspections in 2016, including New Year's Eve, which is a very successful shoot. And in January of 2017, the total number of inspections was 12, with 8 permits issued and a total of $450 in fees collected. The table below, which I provided, and I'll leave for you to judge, is the historical perspective 2017 through 2015. As we transition from winter into spring, we anticipate that these numbers will increase with the prospective construction that's been slated for the upcoming year. And I know that you are very familiar with the projects that are listed, especially the 2 on Exeter Road. It will keep our Fire Prevention Bureau busy for sure. We continue to see a very good response from the hotels and motels as we work to perform the annual inspection of these businesses. We'll send out the monthly newsletters and request monthly letters to request inspections, and they've been very compliant. For our communications division, Hampton Fire Alarm answered a total of 28,280 phone calls in 2016. This translates to an average of 78 calls per day. In January, fire alarm operators answered 1,794 calls this year. To compare, in January of 2016, it was 1,046 calls. A new phone system was installed in July and has been up and running with some minor problems that were ferreted out by Hampton's Internet Technology Department, and we are grateful for their assistance in keeping our business running. As we informed you in our last quarterly meeting, fire alarm operators have been logging hours that the headquarters engine was out of service as a result of subsequent or simultaneous calls, which leaves the shift commander without a crew to respond. This may be a temporary situation while we're waiting for people to come in from home, or it may be that we don't have the response that's necessary, so they're out of duty. This occurred a number of times throughout 2016 for a total amount of 163 hours and 50 minutes. In January, engine one was out of, in January 2017, the engine was out of service for a total of 8 hours and 19 minutes. On the administration side, as we stated earlier, we have a vacancy that we're actively working to fulfill. It's our goal to accomplish this by mid-March so that we have a full complement by the summer season. Since our last visit in November, Hampton Fire Rescue has submitted an application for the Assistance to Firefighters Grant, totaling $85,680. The grant, if awarded, will be used to purchase 2 new consulates, one for each station, and replace the existing Motorola Astros on the apparatus, which are obsolete and no longer in compliance with the FCC regulations, plus 2 portable radios that are also obsolete. Last week, Hampton Fire Rescue submitted an application for a 2016 Homeland Security grant through the New Hampshire Department of Homeland Security, totaling $6,000. This grant's been established to assist communities in purchasing the necessary equipment to outfit personnel that perform EMS in the warm zone, where they may be required to enter into threatening situations to treat victims of all types of violence. This equipment, consisting of a helmet, a vest, and eye protection, allows providers to effectively respond to active shooter or hostile events, and they are protected in a similar fashion as law enforcement professionals they'll be working alongside as a result of the increasing threat to our communities. We're working in concert with Hampton Police to best determine the deployment of personnel if such an event occurs, and we'll update you to the status of both of these grants. The document that I had the deputy pass around to you is an award letter from the state. This grant was submitted, I believe, on Tuesday, and as early as Thursday afternoon, we received the award letter. The state's really hungry to get the towns 2 sets of gear, which is 2 vests, 2 helmets, 2 sets of eye goggles, and then any other equipment that might be necessary to outfit the team that will be working as the EMS team in the warm zone. I'll let Mr. Welch talk about that a little bit more and help me understand how we're going to accept that. But I thank you very much for your consideration, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Jen.
So it looks like continually looking at the years of the calls.
Yes,
sir. I'm sorry, the first section here. 4,517 calls for service in 16. That's continually increased since.
It is.
Looks like it went down a little in 13, but since 13 through 16, it's continually increased.
That's true. Yeah, we've certainly been busier, and it's been trending upwards. Looking back over the call volumes, it's definitely cyclical. You can see that there's rises and falls, but we've seen an upward trend the entire time.
Right, and it's average of 78 calls per day.
That's phone calls. So the
that could be anything.
Right. So in the fire alarm operator's world, the phone is their life, and when that phone rings, they answer it. And they answer it 24/7, 365, with by the third ring. 78 times a day that phone's ringing for them.
And that could be from fires to people at home.
Yep, absolutely, calling with a permit question.
And, yeah, so you guys are remaining fairly busy. You're getting busier, and you're probably going to continue to get busy if we continue to develop.
I would think
and
that
I'd like to thank you, because every time there's a fire down that beach, it makes people very nervous, and you always make sure that it gets put out and doesn't.
The team does a great job, yes, ma'am.
The last one was scary. That was very small quarters.
Yes, ma'am.
So I think the town appreciates all the work you do. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, all right. I don't think I'm supposed to say this anymore, somebody said, but good report. I enjoyed it.
Thank you, sir.
And also I have a couple of questions. When you're talking about mutual aid, can you just explain how that works so the public will understand?
Sure. So I provided a little bit of a narrative of what occurred on that particular fire. If you don't mind, I'll use that fire as an example, okay? So engine 4 arrived, the beach fire engine, right? And it arrived to find people standing outside saying, there's somebody inside. So the lieutenant, based on his training and knowledge and seeing the fire that was inside, called for a first alarm sign. When we are, our initial response, we call it a box alarm, or transmit the box. So you'll hear us say transmit the box. That means that our 2 engines that are capable of responding and the ladder truck will be dispatched to the fire scene. Upon arrival, the lieutenant knew that he was going to be overwhelmed in need of help right away, especially with a potential for a victim, so he called for the first alarm. Typically, each additional alarm calls for 2 more engines and a ladder subsequently. So for us, we've already exhausted our first responding apparatus, which is engine 4 and engine 1 that day. And our ladder truck was out of town. So immediately mutual aid was Seabrook ladder. They came on the transmitted box. When they arrived, they took the side of the building that was accessible through the parking lot, and they went up to do their work. When we transmitted the box, all the alarms, all the pagers at home sound off, and everybody who's listening will, if they're available, come to work. That particular night, as I said, we had an ambulance call. The ambulance was up at Portsmouth Regional Hospital, which is, you know, a little bit, about 20 minutes drive, 15 minutes drive, and maybe 11 if they're coming to a fire, I would imagine. They made it there pretty quick on return, but on callback for that, we had one person in already. When the transmitted box went out, we had two people come in from home and take engine 3. So now all three of our engines were deployed. As you know, engine 2 is out of service. So all three of our engines were committed to the scene. Northampton as mutual aid, Exeter as mutual aid, Portsmouth as mutual aid, Hampton Falls as mutual aid, and Seabrook, which was already on the first alarm. They came in on our first alarm to assist us. Northampton, Rye Ambulance, and I believe, did anybody else come to the scene? I don't think so. They came directly to the scene. Hampton Falls and Portsmouth went to the fire stations to protect the rest of the town. We're all engaged in our battle at the beach. Somebody else now needs to protect the town if there's a subsequent call. So all of our mutual aid companies that were coming in, some went to work, others protected the town for a subsequent call.
And what's the finances behind that? Do we pay for mutual aid or?
No, the understanding is that it's mutual aid. So when they call, we have to go.
Right.
And that actually happened last night as a, God love the Patriots, in the last minute of the game, we were toned out and Engine 1 responded to Kensington for a second alarm. Today, we didn't get called, but Epping had a second alarm at a commercial structure. And had they called for a third, we would be going to that one. That's not a charge to that community, and they don't charge us for a reciprocal.
Very good. I just wanted the public to realize that. And the other thing, this grant, that's really good that you just got. And when you respond to an overdose or Narcan situation where you think there's going to be a situation, do you get backup from the police right away, or do you wait and call after you get there?
We work amazingly well with our police department. It's a great team effort, and they show up at the same time that we do. We're there for the same reasons, and you know we're there to help the public. We have our mission; they have theirs. Generally speaking, a medical call, and this can certainly turn sour quickly. But a medical call, we take the lead; we do what we're going to do. But as evidenced by the Hotel Marianne situation a couple of months back. It's not a medical call. That's a active shooter situation until proven otherwise. But our responders that night from Engine 4, who had come from the beach, they were assisting residents coming down off of ladders from the decks on the rear of the building. To be truthful, they should have been protected as well because the situation was still very fluid. And that's an active shooter situation until proven otherwise. So on a medical call, especially if it's an overdose or something like that, the flavor is a little bit different. Who's doing what? But we work in concert with them every day.
Again, good report.
Thanks.
Bill? Nothing, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Kurt? Yes. What is the status of that property that had the fire at this point?
Well, that evening we conducted a fire investigation, and once we were completed with our investigation photographs and we felt that we had all the information necessary, we turned the property back over to the owner. The owner will then have it, you've seen it boarded up, it's got plywood all over right now. They will make arrangements through whichever company they choose to bring in, and it's usually the insurance company that's assisting them. They'll lock the building up and they'll keep the contents secure. As it stands right now, there are some structural considerations in that building that I know that the second floor deck had burned away approximately 50%, so it wasn't very safe to be on. We assisted residents that night in getting out some of their clothing and medications, but we aren't looking for people to go right back in there. Once it's back to the owner and his responsibility, it becomes his property again. The insurance company deals with that, and then they're going to mitigate it, whatever, you know, if that means tearing the property down, building it back up, however they like to do that. So it's his responsibility now from that point.
Good report. I enjoyed it.
Thank you, sir.
Follow up on Jim's question, and I've got asked this many times.
the engine goes out, the ambulance goes out at the same time, they're going to a medical aid call. Why do they do that?
The same call?
Yeah. Why would you have an engine go with the ambulance?
Sure. Well, basically, we're there to assist. And as I described in the report, we've had a lot of injuries. As I stated, we had one member who retired out as a result of a shoulder injury. He's not the first one. In 2 years' time, we've had two members retire out due to shoulder injuries and surgeries and inability to come back. We're looking to mitigate risk to our personnel. We don't want them to get hurt. This is a very dangerous job, carrying people. It's the nature of the beast that you're carrying somebody down the flight of stairs. It's a dangerous job. But we try to minimize that by having a lot of hands share the work. And so what we're doing is we're bringing the two guys who are on the ambulance to do the actual medical call. There's a lot of equipment that goes along with that, whether it's a board or a chair or oxygen, first in bag, monitor. That is all assisted by the engine company. They'll be there to assist. They'll be there to turn around the ambulance if necessary, especially on a tight driveway situation, so that they're able to just leave the scene once the patient's loaded in the back. Assistance carrying down patients if they're on the second, third floor, coming down in a stair chair, changing over in the middle, whatever it might be. Additionally, if this is a really sick patient, there may be requirements to have more people in the back to assist, or if, God forbid, it's a cardiac arrest call. Anybody who's taken the training understands that you change out rescuers every 2 minutes. You can only do that so long, and then you exhaust all of your rescuers. The goal is to have as many people there to do the job as possible. Now, a lot of people have asked me the same question, why does the engine go? What people don't seem to understand is that our fire engine is our office, and that fire engine is a rolling office, nothing more, nothing less. It's got all the tools that we need to do our job every day. And if they're on a call, whether it's 123 Ashworth Ave or 9B Street, wherever it might be, the next call could come in as soon as they're done with the call they're on, and they're absolutely ready to respond. So it's essential to have all the equipment there so that they don't have to go back to the fire station for anything like that. They're there to provide the service as immediately as possible and then be ready for the next call.
Very good. It's glad to see you got that new lift system in on the new ambulance.
It's an amazing product, I'll tell
you. It's come a long way from when I used to work on an ambulance, and we had the little aluminum stretches, and now you have the ones that lift themselves, and now you got the apparatus to lift them into the ambulance, and does. It helps a lot of the back injuries, a lot of those.
And from what you may remember, having two, three, or four people lifting up on the same stretcher, it's a coordination, it's an effort, and it's teamwork, and that's, you know, nothing to take away from teamwork, but if you're lifting up a 400-pound person with stretcher weight and person weight, that four people lifting that, it becomes a very tedious exercise. Now we're able to do that and allow it to go in. So that's one of our three ambulances. I look forward in the future to speccing out each ambulance to have this lift system.
Do we have to do anything with this grant?
That'll be on the agenda next week, Mr. Chairman, under the statute as a consent item, because it's less than $10,000.
Very good. Okay. I think we're all set.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You. Thank you, gentlemen.
Good evening.
Thank you.
Next thing we have is the town manager's report.
Yeah.
Christy.
No.
Oh. Christy.
Poor Christy.
Christy. I'm sorry, Christy.
I was already up here. We have all kinds of good stuff for you, but I'll try and beat the fire this time. In your email this morning, as well as posted online, we have what I'm going to consider the final report for 2016. I just remind everyone that these are the unaudited financials for 2016. Things are still changing. The auditors will be here February 27th, I believe. So once they come in, that's when I officially close out the trial balance for the town, close the GL out, and we move forward from there. But between now and then, things could change. This is just what I have for now and what I think is a very strong, accurate reflection of our expenses and revenues, definitely our revenues and what I believe to be all of our expenses for the fiscal year ending December 31st of 2016. Let's see. The revenues are currently at $8,005,818. This is over the adjusted budget amount of $6,790,934 by $1,528,206. However, I did note in your report there that the revenues that were used to set the tax rate were $7,612,000. So in actuality, the revenues only came in about $393,000 over what was used when the tax rate was set. So that would be what would be considered the excess revenues for 2016, excess revenues that were collected. Some of the key revenue totals for the year were payment in lieu of taxes at $241,514. Interest on taxes at $304,172. Motor vehicles at $3,420,242. Building inspection permits at $262,198. Federal grants at $149,156. That was the grant for the High Street drainage project that was done in Lafayette, I believe. Rooms and meals tax at $778,228. Highway subsidy at $311,810. State water pollution control at $210,416. Departmental income at $579,023. Rye sewer agreement at $108,251. Parking lots at a net amount of $491,922. The gross amount there was $614,901, with $122,980, which is 20%, being transferred to the Recreation Infrastructure Fund. Land rent at $160,403, and the real estate trust income at $668,170. On the real estate trust, you guys should have all received at the end of last week, I believe, your final reports for 2016 from them also. The expenses are currently running under budget by $571,055. In November, we were under budget by $736,279. So you can see the gap has closed here. It should be noted that the majority of the difference between November and December year end is related to the transfer of $171,242.78 to the compensated leave trust, which at your last meeting, I think I was at January 23rd, the board voted to transfer the money from the employee separation line and the sick buyback, or the buyback, not sick, but the buyback line. When reviewing the attached reports, you will be able to see where each department came in according to their budgets. Although some departments came in at or slightly over the 100%, the budget as a whole ended under budget. The final pages of the report are related to Fund 24, 25, 26, 27, and the wastewater system development charge account. The figures above reflect the information as they are known at this time. I already told you guys all that. It's all about the audit. The auditors are coming on the 27th, so that's when we'll have our final numbers. A few other items that we'll present tonight are: the first one is the investment policy, which the Board of Selectmen need to approve and adopt each year. The only change from last year are related to dates. I have also given this report to Ellen Lavin, the treasurer, for her to approve to see if she needed anything added or deleted, and I got an okay from her today. So if the board is willing to sign that investment policy tonight, that would be helpful. The other item is a summary of warrant articles and purchase orders. These items need a vote of the Board of Selectmen to bring them forward into 2017. So if you'd like, we can do questions on the financials first, and then I can go through the warrant articles and purchase orders, or I can carry on, and then you guys can go back to questions, whichever you prefer.
Why don't you just continue, okay. And then we'll come back with it.
Okay. So the second thing that you guys had was, let me find my copy here, is you get this each year, and basically what it's showing you is the purchase orders that are open at the end of the year, and then it lists all of the warrant articles that need to be carried forward into 2017. I've tried to note whether they are non-lapsing or if they have an expiration date, so to speak, next to the warrant articles, so you can see there are some that will be expiring at the end of March but need to be left open now because we have other bills that we know that are still coming for those warrant articles. So basically the purchase orders for the end of the year totaled $789,707. I would note there, if you look at the bottom, I've kind of given you a rundown of some of the larger open purchase orders, and That 789,000, although it appears to be a large number, it should be noted that 353,000 of that is related to the warrant article for the DPW vehicle purchases. And I believe they have at least received some of those. And I think we might have seen one or two of those bills last week. So that's already been paid. So that's a large chunk of that 789,000. And then there's also 109,000 for the recreation infrastructure. I believe that was for their vehicle that they have coming, their pickup truck, and for playground equipment. I don't remember which playground. It might have been Five Corners, but I'm not sure. But I know Diana was in here talking to you guys about the playground equipment that they had ordered. I know that has been ordered and is being delivered and put in place in the spring, because I don't think it's very, probably not applicable for them to be doing that in the middle of the winter. So those are the, and then there's one more large one, and that was for the DPW department for Jamco, and that's $158,497, and that was for the $180,000 that the board had approved, I believe, for the wall at Bicentennial Park. Is that right, Fred? Yeah.
Yes.
So those are like three large chunks, because I know when people see the $789,000 being a large number, but when you take that off, you bring it down to like $200,000+. So I also included with this report for you guys the list of all of the open purchase orders at the end of the year, so you guys can actually see each of them that are open from 2016. So basically it's a $789,707 for purchase orders, and then I listed out all of the warrant articles, and those total $1,713,024. So it'd be a total of $2,036,979.11 that we are looking to bring forward between the warrant articles and the encumbrances or purchase orders. So that's that item, and all of the warrant articles are listed there. And then the last thing, like I said, was the investment policy. Nothing has changed here. I've just updated the dates and stuff. So I'll pass this around for you guys to sign and return to Fred when you're done.
That's this one, right?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
So we need a vote on all three of those items.
So we need a vote on the warrant article, the encumbrances.
Encumbrances for warrant articles and purchase orders.
Yep.
And a vote on the policy for
the investment policy. Okay.
So would somebody like to make a motion?
I'll make that motion for the encumbrances.
All right.
Second that.
Second.
All those. And just as a point of order, can we please have a dollar figure?
So the encumbrances and the warrant articles together or separately?
Separate. We'll do them separately.
Okay. The encumbrances are $789,707.11.
So we have a motion for that. Second. All those in favor? Unanimous. Now we need a motion on the prior warrant articles to
and
bring them forward.
That's $1,713,024.
Does somebody make that motion?
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. And the last one we need is a motion to accept the Hampton investment policy for fiscal year 2017.
And that has not changed, right?
No, I changed dates, and that's it.
Dates, right. I'll make
and
that
I ran by the treasurer to make sure she didn't want to make any changes. It's because, as you can see, it has more to do with the
bank. So a motion by Jim, seconded by Rick. All those in favor? Unanimous. Any questions for the finance director?
I have a couple.
Okay.
Budget committee noted at the last meeting on January 31st there was confusion about the MS-737, the number on there. Could you explain that so that people at home know?
Yep. They were basically slightly confused on the MS-737 form due to the revenues on that form are $13,017,395, and that differed from the amount that are in the budget book, which was $6,871,000. The basic difference there is in the budget books, you have your operating budget, plus you have what we predict for our revenues for the year, which is in line with that $8 million that I just reported on in my monthly financials for 16. So basically, we put forward a revenue budget. At the time that the budget books are prepared and distributed, and all the way until about September and even November of 17, those revenues basically are just information purposes. They are not there. We do estimated revenues, again, that are due to the state on September 1, and then November they look at the revenues again before the tax rate is set. So those revenues are basically the income that the town brings in from building permits, motor vehicles, payment in lieu of taxes, all those big items that I just hit on for you. The $13 million that is on the MS-737 form includes all of those revenues, the $6,871,000 that I mentioned, but it also includes any offsetting revenue related to the a warrant article that is on the 2017 ballot, or on the warrant to be voted on. So that includes, I listed it all out here, it includes the $307,854 related to the warrant article for the highway block grant. It includes $60,000 related to Article 12, which I believe is the asset management, $16,060, which is related to Article number 13, which was the study, the air study, wastewater water study, $30,000 for Article 44, which was offsetting revenue from the Experience Hamptons. Thank you. And then Articles 27 and 28, which was a total of $189,740. And then the large ones there are related to the bond articles. So it's $5,342,000 for the Lafayette Road plus the church, the force main down at the beach. And then $200,000 for Articles 25 and 31, which was $150,000 for the fire engine and $50,000 for the electronic storage of records. So that's what that whole $13 million is made up of. So
that's awesome.
That's what the main difference was there. It's kind of comparing apples and oranges instead of apples and apples.
I'm glad you explained that, because they were pretty confused. And I think part of the problem was they never had that on their agenda. And I don't believe they ever asked you to come in to explain it. And that's why they were...
Yeah, I didn't even have the report, so...
Yeah, but that's what the main difference is there. And if you go back and look at MS-7s as they were previously known, or MS-737s from, like, last year and stuff, you will see that that number is always higher than what is in the revenue budget that is prepared in the budget books. And it's higher for those reasons. If it wasn't higher, then the number on the MS-737 would have the $5 million that we're looking for in bonds. And all of those extra numbers would be included in there, so it would look like you would need to raise that much more money, and wouldn't be true. We're not going to be spending $5 million in 17 for those bond articles. So that was the difference on those.
Okay, and my other question is, well, actually, it's more of a confirmation from you.
Okay.
In the letter that Mr. Bean referenced earlier, that goes out to whoever it supposedly goes out to in town. It says that lack of publishment of the 2015 audit, but as I recall, we discussed that audit on January 23rd, and actually looking back at the town website, you had actually posted that prior to even the Board of Selectmen meeting, so if people at home wanted to follow along when we were discussing it,
yes,
they could.
Yes.
So I'd just like to point that out to people at home, that that was available as soon as we had, you know, received it. As soon as you had it, pretty much.
Usually whenever I distribute any of my reports, I distribute them to the Board of Selectmen, then the Budget Committee, and then I send it to IT to be posted that day, unless it's something that has to be improved. Like, the investment policy is not up there yet. The previous ones are, but not this one, because you haven't adopted it yet. But now that you've adopted this, this will go up tomorrow. So it's always within, usually the same day that you receive it, unless it's something that needs to be approved by you, it will be placed onto the website that same day.
Thank you, Christy.
Yeah, good report.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I thought you weren't supposed to say that.
I know, but I'll say it. On the revenue.
Revenue, yep.
Yeah, that we take in.
Yes.
I mean, we were not over by much at all.
No.
Per se, and that's an estimated, right? And most of the revenue that you're talking about here, motor vehicles, building inspection permits, federal, it's fairly stable.
Yes.
That revenue is going to come in year to year, you know, fairly. Good idea, which is good. On the expenses, we were over by what, did you say?
We were not over, we were under.
Under, by?
Under. By $571,000. I didn't include a percentage for you this time, sorry.
Okay.
And I don't have that off the top of my head, I have to do some math.
So I know some people would like us to maybe be right exactly there, but that $500,000+ leaves us a buffer zone throughout the year in case we had emergency situations where we needed more money or something. That money, whatever we're under, where does that money go?
To the unassigned fund balance. Once the audit has been performed.
Right. Once the audit's been performed, it goes to the unassigned fund balance.
Yes.
And that's where most years the selectman takes the money to offset the tax rate.
Yes.
Correct. So it's not like, it's not as if we're taking taxpayers' money, overcharging them during the year and then hanging on to it. It's we're making sure that we get through the year appropriately with the appropriate amount of money, and then if there is other money, it goes back to the unassigned fund, which makes it. Also, on the budget, there are a couple of items. I mean, as you said, it was mainly about 90%, right, spent.
I think it was 97.
I would say that's good budgeting.
Yes.
If it's 97%, you know, I mean, if we were in the red, we'd be in trouble and we'd be looking for money. If we're a little bit under, that's not bad. We're in the black, and that's good, and that money's going back to the taxpayers per se by going into the unassigned fund. But there was a couple of items that really stuck out where there was a large increase. Percent increase over what was budgeted.
Okay.
One was, I believe, the emergency management.
Yep.
That was.
That was because we ended up doing the hazard mitigation plan in 2016. We are getting money back. I believe we are still due to get about $7,500. Is that the amount?
That's correct.
That was one of those. They paid a certain percentage, and the town paid a certain percentage, but they could not. The police chief could not file for the grant until all of the bills had been paid to the consulting company, and at the end of December, we still issued her one more check, and I believe as of last week, Richie had filled out all of the necessary paperwork and sent in all the documents so that we will receive the $7,500 back on
right.
that. So in the end, it won't be nearly as high.
Right, right. And that's just something I wanted to point out, because I don't want people looking at it saying, oh my God, they didn't budget that at all appropriately.
Correct.
Because it was budgeted appropriately, it was something we had to do, and it's something that we'll be getting money back on.
And the state requires us to do that so that we can actually file for flood damage for people who live in the town. Otherwise, okay. We can't file without that plan.
Right. So it's a necessity.
Right.
Absolute necessity. The other thing is that I'm sure in the town manager and stuff that when the budgets are made out for the next year and stuff, that people look here and see where they were under budget, where they were over budget, mm-hmm. whether we could get a little closer to what we need, you know, would be the ideal. But in effect, if it was 97% spent, I think
it was 97.29. That number's sticking out in my head for some reason.
I would say that's not bad at all. That's not bad at all. And we're in the black. I would say that's very good. So, and this is on the website, or will be on the website?
It's already there.
It's already there?
Yes.
So
it didn't go up until this morning because I was late because of the deliberative. I got caught up in that last week. Normally it would have gone out on Friday, but it went out this morning.
Okay, so just like the monthly reports are on the website every month?
It's right under, in the same place.
This unaudited, the audited from 2015 is on the website?
Yeah.
The unaudited now will be on the website, and as soon as the audit's finished and we have it back, the audited will be on the website.
And it will be in the town report.
And it'll be in the town report. So anybody can go and look and say exactly where did the town spend the money, what did they spend it on, where did they get the money that they spent it. And this is one, I don't want to open up a big water spout here or something, but if somebody had a question, if a voter, a taxpayer had a question saying, I don't understand this, if they called you, you would explain it, wouldn't you? Yes, I don't want a million people calling you. I'm sorry. But I just wanted to clarify that.
You're going to give them your phone number?
Yeah.
Yes, or an email either way.
Okay.
Sometimes I prefer to do a lot of number things in writing because sometimes
right.
it's harder to understand.
Oh, an email would be much
better. Over the phone,
better.
So I do prefer emails and because in that way I have a reference for what I actually said back. Right.
Okay, thank you very much for your report.
Rick?
I want to thank you for explaining about how those shots that were taken at you, I knew that they weren't valid, and I have to thank you for all that you do. You do a great job, and good report.
Thank you.
I enjoyed it.
Thank you, Mr. Bridle. I just wanted to, I mentioned it briefly in public comment, but this Silberdick diatribe. I will be happy to meet with you, Mr. Welch, and Mr. Silberdick with no cameras, bring the balance sheet, bring our net position statements, bring our income statements, bring the warrant articles, anytime, any place, and demonstrate to him without fanfare, without nonsensical slander and libel, that you administrate one of the finest corporations in New England, if not the country. Mr. Welch has provided that outstanding leadership, as have our department heads, and that most people don't read the financials, and most people aren't interested in it, and most people struggle just to get to work and do their job. And I will be happy to meet Mr. Silberdick with you. And I studied the financials, and I studied in that position. And we drove Gatsby, and we understand there's a $2 million per year depreciation of our capital assets. But we can sit down without fanfare, without an audience, without the yellow sheet, without anonymous groups, and we can sit and we can bear witness to the fact that it is a remarkably well-run corporation. The Whittemore School gave me a degree in business. I have a business. I've served on very large government platforms, much larger than this, much larger than the state, and in my humble estimation, and one that examined your data throughout the town meeting on Saturday for hours and hours, and was just blown away by what a remarkable job you do, what Mr. Welch does, what a remarkable job the people in this town do, because this is the town of Hamptons Corporation. And again, I would wait for Mr. Silberdick's call. Mr. Welch, if you don't mind, Mr. Breidel, if the board doesn't.
That's fine.
For the four of us to sit down in the conference room, where we can spend all that, and we'll go over the balance sheet, the income statement, our bonding, our net position, our bond ratings, anything that Mr. Silberdick wants to do in black and white, anytime, any day. Thank you for the fabulous job you do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Done an excellent job. Thank you for explaining everything you did.
And I also really gave you guys each a copy of my annual report, so you have that too. Right. So I'll just pass this on to you guys. Can sign that, and Mr. Welch can bring that back.
Go get those Patriot t-shirts.
Yes.
Hopefully. Yes. I hope you're not right, but I have to go all the way to Foxborough.
If you do, you do. Just start heading.
A long night, I guess.
Okay, so now we have the town manager's report.
Now, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, for anyone who has a vehicle to register in February or other business in the town clerk's office, please remember the clerk's office will be closed for business from February 17th to the 21st. That's tied up with the state computer system is being changed over. We just don't have access to change all those records upstairs with the state. They have to go through the state to be changed. Property owners who are interested in filing for tax exemptions must see the tax assessing office. Exemptions include elderly, blind, veterans, and solar exemptions, amongst others. There are a few exceptional exemptions that can be applied for as well. Please come in and talk to the assessing office and the town office. And also, don't forget that if you live in the beach and you're in the Hampton Beach Village District, that there is a form to fill out to apply for an exemption from the Village Beach District. That'll affect your property taxes as well. I want to thank the residents who have been removing their solid waste and recycling carts after they are collected by town forces. Your prompt removal after collection has helped the town forces in plowing and sidewalk clearance the last month or so. It's very important. We've had no damage. Everything is working fine, and we want to thank the residents of the community for helping us. That's it, Mr. Chairman.
Any questions for the town manager?
Yes, sir.
Rick?
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Jim?
No.
That was easy.
I'm still punchy from deliberative session.
Okay, old business. We have deliberative session. If anybody wants to have an overview or talk about that? I just had it put on there in case somebody had something they wanted to say about.
I have one thing I like to bring up with the board about a certain petitioned article. I don't remember what number it was about abolishment of the budget committee. I was wondering if maybe the board, if that article were to pass at town meeting, that maybe the board would consider putting together a appointed independent review board so that if the town agrees not to have a budget committee anymore.
I think we should just wait until that happens.
All right, well, I want to throw the idea out there tonight since it was on the agenda.
I don't think it's a good idea to talk about it when it hasn't even been voted on.
I kind of agree with Rick. Don't put the cart before the horse.
Never a good idea to put the cart before the horse.
No, never.
Well,
But I mean, it's a good idea to bring it up, though. I think bringing it up is fine.
I think there was a lot of good discussion the other day. I think I was happy the way the deliberative session went. I think our town moderator did an excellent job controlling that. I'm disappointed that there weren't more people there. I think when we had a one secret ballot vote, I think we had 78 or 79 people vote, and I think that's too bad. But so,
I would say this about the town meeting, Mr. Welch. How much was the budget up last year? Going forward, the budget we presented.
The change in this year?
Yes, sir.
Less than 1%.
Less than 1 cent. 1%. It's very close to 0.072. Is that correct? It's
closer
to
3. About 0.072. That's correct.
So under or right around 0.75%. Just to counter more of that Silberdick letter about mismanagement, and that on the Warren articles, the selectmen don't spend that money. That puts the choice in the voters' hands. Is that correct?
That's correct, sir.
And we have a depreciation factor of about $2 million a year. We've got some serious exigencies. Those have been afforded by your very capable department heads, including Public Works, that's here tonight. That's correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And finally, I would say there were a lot of speakers, and some of them spoke on just about every single issue that came up. I know it's campaign season, but I'd like to remain silent so we can get out of there. We all had things to do on Saturday, but I don't think there was a more cogent and articulate reason for why I support eliminating the budget committee than an esteemed Hampton citizen, Army officer, state representative, longtime public servant, Fred Rice, without any negativity or opprobrium, spoke about why for myriad reasons, that budget committee should not be allowed to continue. And Fred is an honest man, a man of integrity and great public service. And I thought, above all, he put those words together so succinctly. And I would commend anybody to listen to Mr. Rice's remarks on why I support that budget committee not continuing and would not be in favor of a review committee. Again, the budget was up less than 1% this year, despite all of this hyperbole and nonsense from Mr. Silberdick. So again, a great job last year, gentlemen, young lady, Mr. Welch, and department heads. And thank you very much, Mr. Bridle.
Yes? Thank you. I thought the deliberative session went well. I thought there were a lot of people there. A lot of people voiced their opinion, which was fine. There are two sides to different arguments. I think that's fine. I think listening to those who spoke factually is important, and sort of filtering out those who had to put little innuendos in there and things like that. So I think there were some factual people that spoke on both sides of issues, and I think you need to research it yourself as voters, and I think you have to decide what side of the argument you come down on and make your vote known. Thank you.
Oh, actually, I have one thing. Since at the high point, I think we had 80 people, whatever it was, the precinct is having a meeting this Wednesday, and they're going to have some, I think, anyway, of the
department heads
there explaining some of the warrant articles. So if you didn't make the deliberative session, this will probably be a little bit of an abbreviated version of it if you want to come or look at it on TV after.
Okay, the other thing we have under old business is the acceptance of deeds for drainage easements at 167 North Shore Road and 6 Lancaster Street.
Mr. Chairman, if I just might add one other item to the deliberative session.
Sure.
Comments. There's that warrant article number 43 about shifting the responsibility of the default budget determination to the budget committee as opposed to the selectmen. A point was brought up as to whether or not that required, instead of a majority vote, a three-fifths vote. And it turns out I had done some research at that time and determined, yes, it does need a three-fifths vote. It also needs a public hearing noticed in the paper within a certain time frame prior to March 14th. And so I'd also let the manager know that. So I just wanted the board to know that.
So we will be having a public hearing?
The 27th,
and we will so note that in the newspaper?
Yes, we will.
Okay.
Thank you.
Ads for town council's approval tomorrow. So.
Very good.
Thank you.
Okay, now we'll get back to the acceptance of the deeds.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, this situation of at 167 North Shore Road arose last March. It was before the board last March. Was presented was the fact that there was a proposed dwelling which was going to be built on 167 North Shore Road, and the rear portion of the proposed dwelling, it was found there was an old drainage pipe believed to have been there for a number of decades, but without the benefit of a written recorded easement. And so in order to erect the proposed dwelling, it was necessary for the pipe to be moved, the old pipe to be replaced with a new drainage line. And as a matter of that, the drawing there that you see is an older drawing. The garage building that's in the back is not as close to the rear property line as is depicted on this proposal here. But nonetheless, the old pipe did need to be moved. And so what occurred was that the town, as a result, will end up with two drainage easements recorded, one on the property of 167 North Shore Road and the other on the property of 6 Lancaster Street, owned by Mark and Lisa Fratto. And the board actually went through last year the RSA 4114A process that involves the recommendations of the Planning Board and Conservation Commission, followed by two public hearings, and then a vote was taken to accept these easements. And then the task of drafting them was signing of them was going to be accomplished by the surveyor, but that was not quite finished until this point in time, and involved a couple of extra twists. One was that the Fratto property had before a foundation drain that hooked into the spot on terminus of the drainage line. Once it was built, again, has a connection to that line. And so it was necessary under the Department of Public Works practice to have a permit for that drainage line to be there, the foundation line hooking into, connecting with the new pipe, and also for there to be a hold harmless agreement in case anything ever went wrong with what's coming from the foundation drain. Found a hold harmless agreement in favor of the town. And so these were actually accomplished. Another thing that needed to happen is that there was an indication that the town would bear a portion of the cost of the new drainage line, in as much as we did not have an easement before. And that town's share of the cost was worked out through Public Works and the town manager's office to be $4,525, the cost being much more than that. This is a small portion of the share of the costs, representative of a portion of what it took to move this line. And so at this point in time, we're merely asking that the board re-sign the acceptances that were signed last March to be closer in time to the new deeds that were given, and moreover for the board's approval of the $4,525 share to be paid to the Costellas, who had fronted the entire cost of the moving of the line.
Any questions?
This is all stuff that was worked out prior.
Yes, the final cost was not documented until recently, but it was worked out following that.
And it's all reasonable?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, fine. Yeah. Yeah.
So
it's fair. I'll make a motion that we... How should that motion go?
We need to motion to re-sign the acceptances of the two drainage easement deeds and to pay the sum of $4,525 to the Costellos. They having already given us a release of any claims possible in connection with this in return for that sum.
So moved.
I'll second. Second.
Any questions?
Yeah. All
in favor?
Unanimous.
Thank you.
I wouldn't try to repeat either.
Yeah, no.
Anything on new business? Nothing under new business?
Mr. Chairman, if I could have a motion to go into a non-public session under RSA 91-A:3(2)c) e, reputation and litigation matters.
Have a motion by Mr. Bean, seconded by Regina. All those in favor, I need a roll call.
Aye.
Those opposed? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.